We had talked about maybe no more tears. Maybe everyone could share a story about how we met him, or fun facts about Patrick that we may not know. I'll start. So I met Patrick when I was 18 years old. I don't know who you are.
Your ex-niece.
Yeah, right. I was working at Judy's in Stonestown when Stonestown was an open mall. And Patrick was a customer of mine. And it was hate at first sight. Because Patrick and I were the same size. Yes, we were, Rocky. And because he was the customer, whatever I put away in the back, if I didn't buy it and take it home, my manager would make me sell it to him. So I hated him. I couldn't afford it anyway, so it was fine. And then he ended up getting hired and working part-time at the store. And we became great friends because then we had to fight over the clothes that we wanted together. I really miss him. There isn't a day when I don't look at his picture and it warms my heart and makes me smile. Because he was such a kind and generous and charming person. And this past Sunday when it was his actual 65th birthday, I actually went up to Russian River where we used to go every weekend in the summers. And so it was a nice walk down memory lane for me. So thank you for letting me share. And I would welcome Chris.
Okay, I'm Chris. I have two funny stories about Patrick. Patrick and I used to like to party a lot. And we used to plan that we would watch Dynasty together, but the translation is we would just party and have a sleepover. And what we did before is we went to Macy's and bought the most god-awful footy pajamas that we would wear. And then we would give each other facials, and then we would party, and then we'd fall asleep and have a sleepover. And the second thing, if you know Patrick, you know how he loved clothes. And it's not like we didn't have enough money that we could each buy our own jacket, but our money went other places, so we decided there was a jacket made at Macy's, and Pascal still has the bomber jacket. And he didn't have enough money to buy a whole jacket, and I didn't have enough money. But we put our money together, and we bought one jacket, and we shared it, and we had a whole day. So, anyway, this is for you, Patrick. We love you.
Everybody knows I am Patrick. And then I'm the oldest of our group.
Yeah, you're old.
So that's another thing. So I was telling them that almost everybody here grew up together. I mean, Patrick's family and us, we actually lived in the same building up until Armagh actually they found a house down the street.
My mom.
And their dad did not want to leave because he didn't want to leave my mom. I mean, that's how bad it was. And mom had to tell him, you have to go and, you know, start your own home.
Yep.
And that's the only reason we didn't end up staying in the same building.
Mommy tricked daddy.
Yeah. And mom helped her.
Yeah. The women tricked daddy. Yeah.
Yeah,
tricked
them
to buy
their own home. What?
Did
everybody
both have to go
for? Yeah. He made daddy sign a power of attorney.
Mom helped her.
I know, because they lived in one of the flats.
No, that was, they ended up moving there when not I moved. I used to organize his room ever since he was little. Even as a teenager, I would go over to Moultrie and rearrange his room. So I guess that's why I'm his favorite. I used to clean up after.
You clean for a
lot. And then Brady and I didn't like to eat leftovers, and skinny Patrick. Patrick, can you come here and eat the food? We used to call him our vacuum cleaner. I said, can you come in? And he didn't care what it was. Or I said, can you eat that food? Because mom won't cook anything else unless everything is gone. Mm-hmm. Right? So he was our vacuum cleaner.
Yeah.
And then, what else? I mean, there's so many.
And your dog.
Little, what?
To dress him up. Did you guys take him everywhere?
Well, he went everywhere with me. But growing up then, I mean, once they were teenagers or in their, I guess, 18, 20s, and that was the day when everybody was playing tennis. We would go to tennis tournaments together, the Virginia Slim tournament. And of course, you know, that was even thing. So I wanted to learn how to play tennis. And so I'd take them down to St. Mary's Park, Jimmy and Patrick, because they always play tennis. Come on, teach me. And then my ball would go everywhere, and I would stand there. And they're going, can you go get it? It's out of, go get it, you know, if it left the court. And then finally they said, forget it. I can't believe they told me to forget it. And they go take tennis lessons.
They said, you suck.
And I did take tennis lessons. And the instructor said, forget you wear glasses. You wear glasses. And I go, yeah. He goes, put them on. That's it. I said, forget it. I'm not into tennis. I quit. And Patrick, when he worked at the store, what is it, the Daisy, where was it?
Judy's,
whatever it was. Everybody assumes I like to shop. I hate to shop. In fact, even when I'm working, I'd go to a mannequin and I'd tell the salesperson, see that outfit? Can you put that together for me? Because I hated to shop. But Patrick always brought me these things that I would have never bought for myself. Right, people. Okay, look what I got you. I had some of those things that were still in my closet, and I don't know how long, but that's what he did. So and everybody knows in our family that spends the holidays together. Patrick and I were always standing by the stove making gravy. That was our thing. And when Peter wasn't around to go with me to a game, or actually nobody wanted to go protesting with me in the city. Guess what? He was my protest buddy. And so that was a thing. He was a stand-in when Peter wasn't around. He was there for Rocky all of her life. And so for me, he's always been with me. No matter what happened. Oh, and when you come up for Reno for the Reno rodeo, they come up. And I just remember one of your friends. What was his name with that cute guy? Oh, the long hair, Barry. He was so cute with the long curly hair. And he goes, I really love coming here because there's no judgment. And that was the whole thing that I always remember about Patrick and his friends. That, you know, that they did. They would come over, and there was never any thought about who you were, where you came from, and that was us, right? And look at us. Even though we hadn't seen each other for a long time, we have those shared memories. Okay, everybody.
Before he died, he told Janet the most fun he had when he was young, when we took him to Disneyland. And he never forgot that. And he says, and every time he mentioned that to Janet, he would bawl. And he told Janet, says, well, my parents couldn't afford it. Now, neither could I, you know, but we made it. But he looked a lot like me, too, in a way.
Yeah.
And, well, my mom and his dad were, I think, they're first cousins.
Yeah.
And we were all close. He was more like a brother or a son to me. And I'll never forget. You said no tears. I'm gonna cry, okay? I don't care what anybody says. Tears are gonna come out of my eye. I've always been that way, and I will, the day I die, I will be that way also. But anyway, I'll never forget Patrick. And like I said, like my sister Nancy said, we all lived together in the same building for years and years and years. But, you know, that Pedro didn't want to move, like she said, but that's how life is. But I'll always miss the guy. And like I said, we were at the hospital about a week before he passed away, and I told him, Patrick, I never told you that I loved you, but I'm going to tell you that now. And he says, I know you love me, and they'll always be right here, okay? Thank you.
My name is Ed Calivo, or man I call the Ewok. I'm Uncle Pat's favorite nephew. I remember growing up with Uncle Pat and Jimmy, we used to play football a lot. But the memory that I want to bring back, I started dancing hula about 30 years ago. And we used to practice at 24th and Mission. It was a dance studio. We practiced there, I was there about a year. All of a sudden, I see walking across our dance studio, you know, four Filipino guys. But I didn't know what Gapa was. Gapa was...
Oh, Gapa.
Gapa, right? Well, the halalas I danced for is a lot of homosexuals. But we don't judge. They're family. And I attended a couple of those Gapa shows.
Yeah.
Because some of my little brothers were part of it. Well, this one year, we see these four Filipino guys coming. And it's kind of ways, I'm like, shit, I look like Uncle Patrick. they walk through the classroom and they walk into another room. And we hear this music. So we were practicing, we had a break. I'm saying, I'm gonna be nosy. I'm gonna walk over. So I'm up there looking, I open the door, I'm creepy looking. And they got the music going and they're doing their routine. I'm looking, all of a sudden the door cracks, you know, creaks. All of a sudden, turn around, it's Uncle Patrick. So I said, hey, Uncle Patrick, what are you doing? I was getting ready for this show. So they were practicing for about a month. So we're there same on a Sunday, we're practicing, but they got there before us. And we're like, where's Uncle Patrick? He's usually coming after. Well, they got there before us, but he wasn't dressed in the street clothes. They're dressed as women. So they're walking out, I'm looking, and Uncle Pat's waving to me, and some of my hula brothers were like, hey, who's that good looking girl? Have you guys ever seen Uncle Patrick dressed up?
Yeah.
He was a beautiful, good-looking girl, right? And I says, oh, that's a family member of mine. I don't want to tell him that because I introduced him before. Uh-huh. I didn't want to, oh, that's just a family member. So we'll walk out there and go, oh, man, she's beautiful. Is she single? I said, I'm sorry, guys, but she's taken. Right? So when we got done practicing, we went outside the front. And I saw Uncle Patrick. He was out there. He's dressed up. And he introduced me to his fellow cast members, you want to call him. Uh-huh. I said, I got to pay you a compliment, Uncle. He goes, what? He goes, one of my Who's Brothers thought you were beautiful, or you, that was asking if you were single. Goes, is he single? I said, yes, Uncle, but he's not that way. So, you know, and then he took his stride, he laughed, because if he ever changes, you know where I live. And ever since then, you know, I just thought I love Uncle Patrick. I said, we don't judge. That's what I love about my family. If any of you guys ever met my family, we are not Filipino, we're Filipino, Mexican, African-American, Japanese, we're a rainbow. And lucky for my family, if you guys ever noticed for the past 50 years, we've never, ever, ever had color. Me being naive, honestly, I thought everybody lived that way until I got on Siri. Living in San Francisco, then moving to South San Francisco was a total eye change where I did see that I guess what, what's that word I'm thinking of? Racism? Or not racism, but prejudice, right? Yeah. But again, that's my favorite memory of Patrick because when one of my little brothers thought, oh man, she's beautiful, and she's sick, I just had to laugh and say, sorry, she's taken.
That was a good save. Yeah.
He goes, hey, if he ever changes, let me know. I said, sorry, uncle. Never change. But I just wanted to share it with you. I don't think this is the first time I've ever shared it.
I never heard that.
I never told anybody until now. You know, me and Uncle Pat, once in a while, we'll talk about it. You know the thing about Uncle Patrick and Uncle Jimmy, if anybody went on our Reno bus trips, yeah. Those guys had the green thumb or green hand. They could pick a slot machine and they would always win. So, you know, again, those are a couple of memories. I have a lot more memories, but that's just my favorite one. When my little brother thought Uncle Pat was a beautiful one, he wanted to come over there. So thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Everybody's saying these wonderful things about beautiful Uncle Patrick. He's so beautiful, and so graceful, and so talented. But he was a Scorpio. So he was very much a Scorpio.
Yeah, you Scorpios.
Anybody who's here that's a Scorpio knows. Don't mess with her. I remember. Hey!
Oh, sorry.
Auntie Jamie's a Scorpio.
No, she's nice.
And so am I.
No, you're not.
Anyway, Uncle Patrick was more like me than Auntie Jamie. Slow to forgive. But I remember when I was growing up, I went to Woodside, which was like super suburban and very.
Snotty.
It was not snotty. It was just super, like, almost country back then. Like, there was like two Filipino girls in the entire school. And they thought we were Mexican. No, they thought she was Mexican, I was black. Anyway, I told my mom, I have to go to homecoming, and I don't know what to wear. So, but that's okay. I called your Uncle Patrick, he's going to take you shopping. And Nanai has a discounted Emporium. Okay. And homecoming is like, not like a not like Dynasty, it's just like, you know, you wear a dress and it's in the gym. So I go to Emporium with Uncle Patrick and he's like, okay, you know what this? And you need a hat? I'm like, a hat? And you need gloves? I'm like,
gloves?
And I couldn't say no because I had no fashion sense and he was, you know, worked at Judy's, he had all the fashion sense. He had me at homecoming looking like a drag queen. And I had to wear it because he wanted the pictures because it was his thing. It didn't look like
wasn't that hat with the pearl
blue hat
with the little
dress and heels that I could not wear. I could not walk in and gloves. In like the middle of fall. I'm like, okay. Perfect for Woodside in the 80s. Yeah. So yeah, super, super cute if you lived in the city, but if you were in the country, you'd look like a drag queen.
Remember it. Okay. Here comes the loud one.
So, growing up, I had the best of both worlds, a whole older brother and like an older sister, because he was like, what do you call this, your, he knew how to dress, he taught my fashion. No, the one that my, what was that word I had? It was at the, you know, everyone has their follower.
Stylist.
Influencer. Yeah, he was my fashion influencer. So it was like, okay, let's produce, here, let's henna your hair. Oh, let's, you know, dye your hair. No, mommy's gonna get it. I know she's not. Let's just henna. Right? So I learned all of my fashion sense from him. So that's like the best of both worlds. He was my influencer. So thank you.
I've known Patrick. I met Patrick in City College, and I can't quite remember how well. And anyway, I went to Catholic school, and going to City College, there were no nuns running after me to go to class. So we sat there, and he came in, and he looked horrible. And I said, "What's the matter?" And he said, "I just told his good friend Rachel that I was gay, and she doesn't want to be my friend anymore." And I said, "Oh, that's fucked." I said, "That's terrible." And he goes, "Well, do you know what that means?" I said, "Well, it means we're in San Francisco. You're better looking than I am, so you'll probably get the guy." And that's how we became friends for 40 years. And I was welcomed by his family. And he's the last of the family that I've chosen. And I miss him a lot. So thank you.
That's what he did. He taught me, he took us to concerts. Our first concert, wait, where's Demi? Demi just reminded me that he brought Demi and them too to the B-52s at the Civic Center. He brought us to Andy Gibb, right?
Yes, I remember that.
You remember that? Andy Gibb at the Circle Star Theater? Yeah, wherever. Yeah, and then he taught me how to, you know, be social, because he was always around his friends. He always, you know, introduced his friends to us. His first boyfriend, Carlos, actually lived with us when he was just 18, and mommy let him. That was awesome, because then Carlos would take me to school in the morning. So, winner. He was a good older brother. Though he was 11 years older than me, I think we were pretty close. I didn't know a lot about him personally, as I'm learning now from you guys. I do remember not a whole lot, but I try to remember a lot about growing up. But he, if it wasn't for him, and I share this, I wouldn't have my home today, because he was the one that helped me purchase my house. And I did pay him back before he passed, so back to money. There's just a lot of things. He was fun. He was like a great older brother. Like I said, I stole. He knocked my door down. Like, I was like, oh, shit. But he would never be that mad at me. Before he passed too, I made him mad. I didn't mean to. So I know we've forgiven each other. But I guess that's what older brothers do, right? They want to make sure you're doing the right thing. But I just want to thank him for being there as much as he was for us. We missed him for about 7 years, but thank God, God brought him back to us. My mom, I know she was here today. She'd be so happy that we're throwing this for him. She actually sees him, so you guys know my mom talks to my brother and Christopher, and she keeps telling them, "No, I do not want to die yet. Do not come for me." She tells them, she's not ready. She's telling them every day. I know. She's like, "Don't come for me." But she, I think she really do see them, and they're asking for it, but she's really not ready to go. So if you guys want to talk to Toto or Chris, just talk to mommy. She'll send them the message. So thanks for
coming. Real quick, since we're talking about Patrick Park, Scylla have a party in his apartment.
Yeah, John has right, a chaperone.
And I got to be the chaperone. So he trusted me
right,
in that.
Some chaperone.
Yes, I was a really good chaperone. I did have one question. I said, thank you, Patrick, for not letting me. Piece of the cake was back on. She broke a wishbone and wished for a sign. I told her whispers. But the, he was right.
She could do. I feel for her.
Off of that was that he just recently told us that the song from Rick James is when they talk about Get to Me Baby. That was, I didn't know that. So fun fact. If you guys didn't know, that's what he told me.
Yeah.
He didn't know that.
Yeah.
I haven't spent as much time as you guys have. But
I'm happy he told us that we made him happy when we took to Disneyland. And one thing I remember about him too is when he was little, he used something, I don't know if it was something he knows, but he knew all the commercials on TV. He was doing Peek and Polly.
Yeah, you know, Mom said he talked too much.
Huh?
That's what Mommy said, he talked too much.
Yeah, but one time he said, oh, I mean, we went to see him at the hospital. That's the first thing he told us. You made me happy that you took me to Disneyland. And then I'm happy on the day we'll meet your parents. Because my parents was with us when we took him to Disneyland. And then he was sitting there watching the TV, commercial come on. And he go, he said everything, exact every word in the commercials. And that's how I remember one of my memories of him. Even though I haven't had that much time with him, I'm happy we made him happy. Thank you.
Thank you. And I don't know how you do it. He goes, what? He goes, you laying here, you know your situation, but you're taking a stride. Me personally, I wouldn't have. If someone told me today I was dying, I don't know how to take it. But you would never know that he was sick.
Yeah.
And, yeah. I'm going serious, but I'm trying not to. But I really respect him more when he said, because I don't know how anybody can go through that knowing that he may not be here the next day, but not, I mean, he was Uncle Pat. And then when I told him I loved him, the last time I see him, I still got in my mind. I just have so much memories, but I respect him so much. I even Uncle Jimmy too, but just my Uncle Pat, but like I said, he was so stoic. I mean, he didn't care. He didn't have nothing, like, you know, it's like, I'm going day by day. I don't care. And he told me I'm ready. And I just, you know, I commend him for that, because I wouldn't know what to do right now if someone told me I was going to be here tomorrow or a week from now or whatever. But he took it in stride. That gives me strength now, even though I'm crying like a little girl right now. I just commend him for that. Thank you for that.
A couple months before he passed, Dennis had us over for Easter. And he was still pretty sick at that point, really, really weak. So Pascal and I went to pick him up. So I set up a bed in the back in case he wanted to lie down on the way to Dennis. So I told him I have a comforter and I have a pillow. And he looked at me and said, honey, I'm not going to use it. I need to look pretty when I arrive. I don't want to mess up my hair.
The house on Walter Street, my dad and his dad at Bedlam, they wanted to paint the house. Well, it was Patrick, myself, and Fred Tomatino. We would go back and we were painting the side of the house since we were so skinny. It was about maybe 6 inches between next door. It was so small. So we got up there and we painted. And Patrick picked up a brush and he was so fluent in painting. He knew automatically what he was doing, right? And I'm supposed to be the senior guy who's, well, younger than Patrick, to paint. And Fred Tomatino was like all over the place. So he got stuck in the middle and we had to go fix his work. But Patrick was so fluent and smart to pick up a brush. I mean, before the first time, and he knew how to, you know, fluently paint. And it was like perfect. I didn't have to tell him. You know, and then afterwards he let me use his purple Stingray bike and I would ride it up and down Mulder Street. That's how I learned how to ride a bike. Pretty much was using Patrick's bike. And then he helped me fix that, do that. You know, so thank you. That we can set aside to show just how much we love you. And I'm sure you would agree. What could fit more perfectly than to have a world party on the day you came to be? Happy birthday!
take me by the heart and you take me by the hand.
Here's what we're